Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Welcome to a live session of Ask an Imam. My name is Farhan Iqbal and this is a live program where you can ask any questions about Islam, about the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, about other world religions. Answers are provided in light of resources found on the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, that is www.alislam.org, A-L-I-S-L-A-M.org, the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. You're watching this program on multiple platforms that includes Twitter, Facebook, and YouTube, and any of these platforms. You can join the conversation today by using the comment section or the live chat on the platform that you are using. Today, I would like to share some of the highlights that were mentioned in the recent address of Huzoor Anwar, may Allah be his helper, during Jalsa Salana, UK, where he mentioned some of the progress of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community over the course of the past 1 year. It's fascinating that despite COVID-19, despite the pandemic, the Ahmadiyya Muslim community was able to progress so much over the course of just 1 year. Huzoor mentioned that, for instance, the Jama'at has been established, the number of new Jama'ats established in the world is 403. And Ahmadiyya was established for the first time in 829 locations or places. Huzoor mentioned that the Ahmadiyya Muslim community was able to establish a total of 211 new mosques, out of which 135 were newly built and 76 buildings were converted into mosques. He highlighted the establishment of various mosques around the world, such as in Sao Tome, Belize, and Zion, USA. Huzoor said that during the year, 123 new mission houses were established in different parts of the world. Huzoor mentioned that in terms of the publication of new books, we have the Raqeem Press, which is doing great work in Africa. With regards to this press in Farnham, UK, the number of publications printed from there over the course of the year is 315,000. This is the progress that is made since the previous Jalsa Salana. So that's 1 year since the last year. There was not a formal Jalsa Salana, but there was still a virtual program where Huzoor addressed us and told us the progress of the Jama'at in that year. Huzoor also said that during the year, the translation of the Holy Quran in English has been revised. Four more books of the Promised Messiah, alayhi salam, have been translated into English. The third volume of Malfuzat was also translated into English. A book of Hazrat Khalifatul Masih the first caliph of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, radiallahu anhu, is being translated and will be published this year. Huzoor also mentioned that Ruhani Khazain has been published again in an excellent and beautiful manner, and various other publications were highlighted in his address. Huzoor also mentioned that during the year, according to a report from 92 countries, 384 different books, pamphlets, and other publications were published in 39 languages, of which 3,688,000 copies were printed. Huzoor mentioned that the number of books and literature sent to various countries is 75,745. 591 central libraries were established in 90 different countries. 1,970 various exhibitions were held, which were attended by about 175,000 people. Huzoor mentioned the progress in the work of different translation desks. Huzoor mentioned the progress in press and media. Huzoor mentioned the progress in the Al-Islam website, He said that the Al-Islam website has been developed, has developed a new Quran browser, a new version of which is launching with the Jalsa Salana. There are a total of 316 books on the Al-Islam website and over 1,000 Urdu books available. Furthermore, various audio books have also been added to the website. In terms of progress with MTA, Huzoor mentioned that by the grace of Allah, 8 MTA channels are operating 24 hours a day. Huzoor mentioned that the Ahmadiyya Muslim community has a total of 27 radio stations in various different countries. So this progress and progress with various other schemes, various other projects and organizations and magazines. This progress was mentioned in the address of Huzoor Anwar, may Allah be his helper. So I just wanted to take an opportunity today to share some of that progress that has been mentioned by Huzoor Anwar, may Allah be his helper, in his addresses, and share it with you today. All right. Something wrong with my browser here. Let me try to fix that. Okay. All right. Sorry about that. Just a little bit of a fix I have to do. Okay. Yes, I'm going to have to wait until the end of this program to fix this. All right. Anyhow, so this is an Ask an Imam, as I've mentioned before as well, where you can ask any questions about Islam, about the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, about other world religions. Answers are provided in light of resources found on the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. So you can use any of the resources, either the live chat or the comment section to ask your questions, and I will be taking your questions now. Answers are provided in light of resources found on the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. Okay, I seem to have fixed my problem here. Okay. All right, some of you have said salam. Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. This is my first question for today. Is not doing what is sunnah a sin or punishable? And is witr prayer obligatory? So the Holy Quran is very clear on this, that we should follow the uswa or the practice or the sunnah of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Holy Quran says that whatever the Messenger of Allah gives you, you should take it. Fattakhizu. And whatever he tells you not to do, you should not do it. So this is very clearly mentioned in the Holy Quran. So in light of that, obviously, if someone is actively trying to ignore the sunnah, then that would be a form of sin. Having said that, it does not mean, you know, some people become very extremists and they might say that, you know, when it comes to the sunnah, it was part of the sunnah that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to travel on the camel. And so we should all travel on camels, right? So that becomes practical, and so that would be an extreme when you say it that way. But there are many aspects of the sunnah that are related to obligatory matters. For instance, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us the way to offer the salat. So if someone actively refuses to follow the way the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam offered the salat, it means that that person has deviated from following the right way, because first of all, offering salat is obligatory. Second of all, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the one who has shown us how to offer that prayer. And we cannot just on our own decide to not follow the sunnah of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. By the way, I was mentioning some of the, I'll get to the second part of your question in just a second. I was mentioning the progress of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. This is available on Al-Islam as well, extraordinary progress of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community throughout the year. And this is a summary of the address at the third session of Jalsa Salana UK. And you can get those facts and figures that I was mentioning from this page. If you go on the main page of Al-Islam also, it's in the What's New section. What's New from August 7th is where you will find this. I forgot to mention this when I was talking about it just a few minutes ago. Okay, so yes, back to the question. When it comes to the sunnah of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in those things like offering salat or reading the Holy Quran or those kinds of essentials of our faith, then obviously we have to follow the sunnah, and it would be sin to not follow the sunnah of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But there are some aspects of the sunnah that are impossible in the sense that, for instance, it was his sunnah to travel by the camel or some other aspects of his life. Sometimes some people are so in love with the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that if they have the chance to ride a camel and they do it with the intention that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did it, and so I also want to partake of it, then there's blessing in that as well, right? Now, you have asked about, again, which is something related to salat, whether or not witr prayer is obligatory. The answer to your question is that in terms of our salat, there are various gradations that fuqaha, that jurists have given to the aspects of the salat. So there is the salat that is farz, which is obligatory. There is the salat which is sunnah, which is something that we get from the practice of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And there is the salat which is wajib, which means that you have to do it. You should not knowingly, intentionally ignore that prayer. But if you miss it for genuine reason, then there is no need to come back and offer it. So among the wajib prayers, we have, for instance, the Eid prayer. And we have the witr prayer also as a wajib prayer, in the sense that if someone misses the Eid prayer, let's say someone is with a good intention is going for Eid prayer, and they get there's an accident on the road and they get stuck in that traffic and they're not able to make it to the Eid prayer, then there's no obligation on them to fulfill the Eid prayer on their own. If they missed it, they missed it based on genuine reason, and that's fine. Their intention was not there to miss it. So that's where the wajib form of prayer is. And is witr prayer, witr prayer is also like that, that if someone, based on a genuine reason, let's say someone wanted to wake up in the early in the morning to offer tahajjud prayer and witr prayer, but if they missed it, then there's no requirement for them to come and offer witr prayer at a later time. Not that this is encouraged that someone is always saying that they will offer witr prayer early in the morning and they are always missing it. That should not be the case. I'm talking about those cases where it can happen once in a while. So this is what is wajib prayer is. And then, of course, the sunnah is of a higher level, that the prayer which the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to offer. So we have the first prayer, for instance, in the Fajr prayer, we have the two rak'at of first prayer and two rak'at of sunnah prayer before. The sunnah and farz are both the kinds of prayers that the worshippers have to offer. Okay. This is the next question I have for today. Why did Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam say that angels do not enter a house in which there is a dog or a picture? So when it comes to having a dog or a picture, we must keep in mind that according to the ahadith, we should not have a dog that is in a private space in our homes, because there is a level of, you can say, hygiene that is expected in Islam. Having a dog, for instance, in certain societies, it is common for them to let the dog inside the bedroom, and they even allow the dog to sleep with them in the bed. That is a kind of extreme, closeness to an animal like a dog that is not encouraged in Islam. And that's primarily due to hygiene reasons. If somebody wants to keep a dog, let's say for security purposes or something like that, and the dog has a special adjacent place in the house to be present that doesn't have access to the more private areas like the kitchen or the living room or, you know, very private areas, then that is okay. But to allow it to be inside the bedroom or anything like that, that is something that Islam does not allow. And that's what the hadith that you're referring to mentions, that angels do not enter the house in which there is a dog. The other part about the other hadith, which speaks about a picture or something like that, that is in reference to the paintings or other kinds of handicraft or other things that the Quraysh at the time of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam would make, or other people, some merchants would make, that would have their deities or idols painted on them or drawn on them. And that is something that is not allowed according to Islam. It is not a reference to any kind of painting or picture in the house. It is a reference to those kinds of pictures or those kinds of paintings that can take the form of shirk, or that do take the form of shirk or idolatry, or even if they are not directly related to idolatry, they may be indirectly linked to idolatry or idolatrous practices, which Islam forbids. So those kinds of images which can lead a person, or which have a link with shirk or practices that are idolatrous, those kinds of images, those kinds of pictures, those kinds of idols are not allowed should not be kept in a Muslim household. But other forms of images, that is different, right? Now, this is also the reason why these kinds of practices which are linked to shirk. For instance, we have practices like Halloween or other kinds of, Valentine's Day or something like that. These activities or customs have roots in pagan traditions. So Islam forbids that as well, because anything that can lead to idolatry, or anything that has even a remote link with idolatry, can be dangerous. And it can, in principle, things that, let me explain this. So in Islam, even going near evil is something that we should avoid. The Holy Quran is very clear. وَلَا تَقْرَبُ الزِّنَا. Do not go even near to idolatry. So going near idolatry, adultery, is something forbidden in Islam. And the idea is that if you, and I was talking about this in my discussion yesterday as well, that if a person goes to a place where alcohol is sold and says, I will never drink alcohol, a day will come when that person will partake of alcohol. So keeping away from alcohol, keeping away from environments which can trigger a person to drink alcohol is also part of Islamic teachings. So in the same way, those images, those practices, those behaviors, those customs that even remotely link to idolatry should be avoided, because then the Muslims, there's something called ghera. There's something called, it's something akin to jealousy for your beliefs or something like that. Solidarity, you can say, with your beliefs. If you reach that level of just, other kinds of traditions and customs, that you start adopting them. I mean, tolerating is one thing. Being tolerant of other people's faiths, that's also an Islamic teaching. That's one thing. In fact, Islam even says, the Quran says that, do not even speak negatively of idols, otherwise those people will speak negatively about God, right? So the Quran has gone to that extent. Now, tolerance is one thing, but to start adopting those things and sort of letting them into one's family and one's cultural traditions, that can be dangerous, even if it's not seen as dangerous today or tomorrow. It might be something that is down the road, that is for the next generation, maybe, that can be dangerous. So I know I've given a long answer to your question, because I didn't have a lot of questions so far, but this is the philosophy. Excuse me. This is the philosophy in Islamic teachings in regards to this. All right. David is asking that, I am ready to commit my life to Islam as a religion. What do I do next? You can reach out to us through the email askanimam@alislam.org, and we can discuss some details. But normally what happens is that there's an affirmation of faith, right? In the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, we have a form where it starts with the affirmation that, I bear witness that there is none worthy of worship except Allah, and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the messenger of Allah. That after that affirmation, we commit to a life that adheres to the Islamic principles, right? We have 10 conditions where those Islamic teachings are basically, the 10 conditions of bay'ah, as we call it, or pledge of allegiance. They are basically a summary of the Islamic teachings as found in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, seeing those, having made that commitment, the next step is to, begin the change, the gradual change in one's life, to become a Muslim, and to begin adopting the Islamic lifestyle. So that would the one of the first things we ask those people who join our community is to learn how to offer the Salat. We have on alislam.org resources that can help you do that. Let me show it to you. You can go there, or you can reach out to us through the email and we can talk about it. But basically, the Salat, just type in Salat and you will come across the online Salat guide. So you can learn Salat from here. There is some audio MP3 as well to help you. And then on the same section, there are related books. Salat, the Muslim prayer book, is what you can start with to understand how to offer Salat. And Salat is offered 5 times a day, and the book talks about it. But for new converts, the best thing is to take it at a slow pace, maybe set a target that in the first couple of weeks, you're going to offer at least one of the prayers on a daily basis, because this is a habit building process. And then if you can start tomorrow or today with the 5 daily prayers, that is up to you. But if you spread it out and try to gradually increase your prayers and the salat. You can do that as well. Start offering the prayers on their designated times. And the book that I just showed you talks about those times as well. That's one of the things you should do. Another aspect of the Islamic faith is financial sacrifices. So sacrifices made in the way of Allah. That is also something that you can start with. Even if it's $1, $2, or $5, any small amount that you can give in the way of Allah, you should be ready to start doing that. Maybe once a month or the beginning of the month, you can start that. The first thing, in fact, is that you learn how to do wuzu. Again, on the same page that I showed you, you should have the doing wuzu as well and offering a prayer. That's the first thing. And then signing the form and all that, it goes from there. All right? Okay. All right. So these are the questions I got for today. If I don't have any more questions, then we can conclude. Just wanted to mention that today I talked about the highlights of progress of the Jama'at in the last 1 year as presented by Huzoor Anwar, may Allah be his helper, in his Jalsa Salana address of the second day. And the way to find that address is to just go on the main page of alislam.org and scroll down on the What's New section. You'll find extraordinary progress of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community throughout the year, and you will find this address, the transcript, and or rather the summary. It's not a transcript, the summary of that over here. And you can also, just on the same page, click on the video link or the audio link to listen to it, just the audio. On the related content, you have Fulfilling the Rights of Others. That's the third day address of Huzoor Anwar, may Allah be his helper, from the Jalsa Salana, Rights and Responsibilities of Men and Women, Righteousness and Mutual Love, Fulfilling the True Purpose of Jalsa. So all the related addresses as well show up on this. This is in the library section as well. For in the future, right now I showed you from the What's New section, but the What's New section will keep on updating. So in the library section, what we have is the personalities. Okay, so I think it goes from here. We have the personalities, okay. On the right side, it says Ahmadiyya Muslim Community. Then it says personality. So click on personalities. And when you click on that, Hazrat Khalifatul Masih the fifth, may Allah be his helper. So under his personality, his profile is there. His addresses are there. So from here, you can find all the material and all these books, that have been authored by him, and the videos and the addresses on the right side here, addresses and articles, they're all listed on the side. So you can click on more addresses, for instance. You click on more addresses and you find these addresses by Hazrat Khalifatul Masih the fifth, all listed and available here. The latest one, the last address of Jalsa Salana UK, the concluding address. And then before that is the extraordinary progress of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community throughout the year that I have talked about today. All right, so that's all the time I had, and that's all the questions I had also for today. I really appreciate all of you who joined me for this discussion today. Jazakallah, and assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammadin wa barik wa sallim.